This is Sirius, the brightest star in the sky, and it's been weird since we started sciencing it. The more we learn about it, the weirder it gets, and astronomers are still trying to figure it out. Hey, crazies. Unless you live in Svalbard or something, you've probably seen Sirius. It's not a particularly large star, only about 1.7 times the diameter of the sun, and only twice the mass. The reason it's so bright is because it's only about 8.5 light-years away. We're basically stellar neighbors. But almost 2 centuries ago, we began to notice something weird about Sirius. In 1809, Friedrich Bessel, mostly known for his mathematics, became the director of an astronomical observatory at the age of 25. One night, he looked into the sky and noticed that Sirius was wobbling. Actually, no. It would be wonderful if astronomy was that easy. In reality, very little astronomy is done by looking at the sky. These days, astronomers spend most of their time in front of a computer writing or debugging code. Back in Friedrich's day, it was all about stellar catalogs and paperwork. That whole star party thing is just the way we sell it to new students.
Oh, so this class is just a waste of time then?
Look, I know I'm underselling this, but bear with me for a moment. Friedrich Bessel was looking through data that stretched back 80 years, some of which was collected before he was even born. I mean, have you ever gotten to open an old book and peruse its contents? It's an experience. And Friedrich got to do that for 2.5 decades before he noticed the problem with Sirius. At that point, he painstakingly double-checked old catalogs against newer ones, and then triple-checked them against his own measurements. That work took an additional decade, so no one heard about it until 1844, when Friedrich was at the ripe old age of 60. Astronomers play the long game, okay? But the payoff was big. He noticed the right ascension of Sirius was weirdly changing.
What the heck is right ascension?
Okay, here's a little primer on celestial cartography. You know how we have latitude and longitude on the Earth to help us navigate and stuff? Well, we do that with the sky, too. Except we call the latitude declination, and we call the longitude right ascension. It lets us map out the locations of all the stars in the sky. Friedrich Bessel noticed that Sirius's right ascension was changing. Out of context, that wasn't all that surprising. Binary systems were already known to do this. Except Sirius wasn't a binary system. It was a single star. How could a star wobble all on its own? The most reasonable conclusion here is that it wasn't alone, and that's exactly what good old Friedrich thought. It must have a companion he couldn't see. A dark companion. Or, to put it in his own words,
"The existence of numberless visible stars can prove nothing against the existence of numberless invisible ones."
Friedrich was correct that this companion existed, but it wasn't invisible. It wasn't even dark. It was just very small, very dim, and so close to Sirius that it was inside its glare. It would be another 18 years before anyone would see that companion. And believe it or not, the first person to see it was a hobby astronomer named Alvan Clark. Alvan didn't realize the significance of this discovery. He was just a huge fan of binary systems and loved to tell local astronomers when he found a new one. Don't let anyone tell you your hobbies are a waste of time, folks. The point is, there was finally photographic evidence that Sirius had a companion. What it didn't have was a name. Standard procedure with binaries is to label them with capital letters according to brightness. So the brighter one is Sirius A, and the dimmer one would be Sirius B. But humans love a good nickname. For a long time, we called Sirius A the dog star, since it's the brightest star in its constellation, the big dog. I mean, Canis Major. So quickly after its discovery, Sirius B came to be known as the puppy.
"You're the cutest puppy, yes you are."
But anyway, weirdness solved, right? Or so we thought. Sirius B is especially dim, but even back in Alvan Clark's day, that wasn't unheard of for stars. It didn't raise any red flags until we got more data on it. Thanks to Friedrich Bessel, we knew the orbital cycle was about 50 years. But the cycle length or period is not the only property of an orbit. We'd also like to know the size of the orbits, how elliptical they are, and ideally their orientation. For that, we'd want to watch the Sirius binary for a full orbital cycle, or at least most of it. Again, astronomers play the long game. By the time we got the data we wanted, though, we had learned a lot more about stars, and Sirius B wasn't fitting any of the patterns we saw in HR diagrams.
What is an HR diagram?
Oh, they're a really big deal for stellar classification. If you've ever seen one of these diagrams, it might have been confusing because astronomers can be pretty traditional with their labeling. But basically, an HR diagram is a plot of brightness against color. Brightness tells us energy output, and color tells us surface temperature. But that's not all. If we plot thousands of stars, we begin to see patterns. For example, the main sequence is all the stars in the first stage of their life, burning hydrogen. They're bright because they're hot, or dim because they're cool. Stars in the later stages of their life clump together too, in even brighter bubbles, but because they're giant rather than hot. The point is, we can immediately tell a lot about a star based on where it falls on this diagram. Since Sirius B was so dim, we expected it to be with the other dim stars we call red dwarfs. In other words, we expected its mass to be really low, like one-third the mass of the Sun. Except that's not what we found. In 1910, Louis Boss published the preliminary general catalog of 6,188 stars for the epoch 1900, which is a long-winded way to title a star catalog if you ask me, but whatever. This catalog contained all the orbital info we wanted for Sirius, which ultimately allowed us to get the mass of each star in the system. And to our surprise, Sirius B was almost exactly the mass of the Sun, three times higher than expected.
What?
As you can imagine, astronomers were perplexed. They tried to hypothesize some mechanism that maybe made some stars colder even though they had a higher mass. Yeah, not so much. 4 years later, Walter Adams finally measured the surface temperature of Sirius B, and he got 25,000 Kelvin, over four times as hot as the Sun. Sirius B was not a cold red star. It was blue. Super dim, but hot as blazes?
Surely the data was just wrong.
First, don't call me Shirley. Second, Walter's work was reproduced and verified. Sirius was officially weird again. Seriously. But there's only one way it could be dim and hot at the same time. It must be insanely tiny. See, the Stefan-Boltzmann Law was already well established in 1914 when Walter took his measurements. If temperature is higher, but the energy output is lower, the surface area of the star must be very small. That would mean Sirius B was way denser than anything humans had ever seen or even dreamt was possible. Somehow this star has the mass of the Sun compressed into an object the size of the Earth. To put this in perspective, imagine cramming something like a mountain into a semi-trailer. The very thought of it feels completely bonkers. Famous astronomer Arthur Eddington's response to this was,
"Shut up, don't talk nonsense."
Yes, that's a direct quote. In his defense, though, he did regret saying it later. And to be fair, we didn't know of any mechanisms at the time that would make densities like that possible. We'd have to invent quantum mechanics, and that wouldn't happen for another decade. Which is a topic that deserves its own video. What matters is that Sirius B wasn't an outlier. We soon began to find other stars with similar properties, forming a new group that came to be known as white dwarfs. And as it turns out, they're not stars at all. They're stellar remnants. They're what's left behind when lower mass stars end their existence. Weirdness solved yet again, which again exposed more weirdness. It's like astronomical whack-a-mole. Sirius A might be the papa dog right now, but Sirius B was more massive and much larger back when it was active. We estimate it was about five times the mass of the Sun, or 2.5 times more massive than Sirius A. The puppy was once papa dog, but has since shed a lot of its fur. Am I taking this dog analogy a little too far? Whatever. Remember, Sirius B...
Remember!
Sirius B was a stellar remnant!
Doing it again!
Yes. Remember, Sirius B is a stellar remnant. It's more like a skeleton than a puppy. At the end of their lives, lower mass stars begin to shed their outer layers. This'll start for the Sun in about 4 to 5 billion years. There's no sudden explosion for these stars. They just kind of fizzle out. What's left is a white dwarf surrounded by a diffuse nebula.
Why don't we see a nebula then?
Because it's long gone. We can only see these nebulas because the white dwarf at the center is fresh and emitting lots of ultraviolet light, which ionizes the gas in the nebula, making it glow. Once the white dwarf cools off a bit, the amount of UV drops and the gas neutralizes. It becomes essentially invisible after 50,000 years or so, and then gradually dissipates into the interstellar medium. Sirius B finished shedding its material somewhere around 126 million years ago. The nebula was gone before humans even evolved on this planet. But there is one problem with these timeframes. Rewinding the clock, say, 130 million years, the star would still be in its giant phase, meaning it would have been 40,000 times wider. Also, Sirius B wouldn't have lost any mass yet, meaning the orbits would have been smaller. Sirius A would have been inside Sirius B. Now, we are aware of these things called contact binaries, where the outer edges of the stars are touching and exchanging material. But Sirius takes this to the extreme. How could one star survive inside the other? And if they were that close together, tidal forces would have made those orbits circular. Yet somehow the orbits are highly elliptical today. What gives? Unfortunately, we don't have a solution to this final weirdness yet. We're obviously missing some piece of information, or there's a scenario we haven't considered. I don't know what that might be, but it's nice to know that there are still some unanswered questions for astronomers to solve in the future. They do play the long game, after all. And until next time, remember, it's okay to be a little crazy. Catmate8358 says they don't like the names dark matter or dark energy. To be honest, I don't either. They're terrible names. Dark matter isn't dark, it's invisible and intangible. Dark energy is the lowest possible energy of space-time itself. What do you even call something that abstract? Thanks for watching. Half my comments are gonna be like, dwarf.